As announced at the end of the last lecture, I'd like to make some preliminary remarks about web design in general and also about my design background before we get down to details. In very broad terms, we can say that a web page manifests itself to users as content plus its presentation. While it is obvious to most that different content will have to be presented differently, many aren't quite aware of the fact that how content is presented, what we call design, to a great extent determines what sense people make of it. So these interact with one another. Psychology impacts both content and design, but the degree of influence will often depend on the type of website we're considering. The two extremes are provided by platforms such as Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, YouTube, etc., or forums, wiki sites, comment boards, and so on, where the individual user has little control over the design and the designer of the platform has limited control over the content, even though these limitations are more and more lifting on both ends. Between these extremes, the publisher will take charge of both content and design, even though he may have to sacrifice flexibility to some extent when using template-based website builders, website creation tools, or e-commerce-ready platforms. In order to understand the relationship between content and design a little bit better, let's take a look at three most popular website types, starting with e-commerce. Now here, understanding behavioral and cognitive psychology will obviously help overall and for all websites in this category in a similar manner. For content creation, we need to cater to instinctive, emotional, as well as rational sides of our users with suitable product descriptions, proper selection of images, pricing considerations, testimonials, user ratings, references, safety assurances, and all the other things we will discuss in detail. Regarding design, we need to make sure that users can easily find what they're looking for, unclutter the display, and direct users' attention to products. Group related items so information can be easily digested, but at the same time set the mood with colors and typography, etc. As a second type, we might consider a blog. Here, specifics for content creation will depend on the topic, but nevertheless, we need to pay attention to issues such as writing style, chunking and paragraphing, scannability of the content, breaking of text, etc. in all blogs. On the design side, navigational elements, visually balanced layouts, structuring of content with headers and subheaders, typography, font sizes, alignment, text width, stylizing links, and so on are the things that matter. The third type we might consider is a media website where rich content and its suitable presentation are key for success. Here, a consistent design with proper use of colors, grouping by similarity, proximity, common regions, use of good continuation, etc., are especially important for structuring and laying out the content for easy digestion. Don't worry if you don't understand what all this means. You will have learned all this and much more by the time you finish this course. In addition, user interactions as well as social feedback become especially important here. In general terms, we can say that web design is the arrangement of elements of content within a meaningful composition. We need to appreciate, of course, that web design has inherited a lot of know-how from art forms that preceded it, such as publishing, illustration, lithography, typography, industrial design, and more, developed over many centuries. Unity, balance, proportion, etc. are not new concepts, and neither are topics in cognitive psychology, such as inattentional blindness, gestalt theory, color theory, and so on, that we will study. But obviously, the greatest influence has come from designing computer interfaces over the last 40-odd years. Early operating systems with graphical user interfaces were simple in their look and feel, constrained in their complexity by technology rather than by the designer. But nevertheless, using only two colors for the first Macintosh, Apple managed to convey depth, textures, buttons, and icons that mimicked real-life objects. This is called skeuomorphism, and it was a brilliant idea to use this type of design so people would easily adapt to using graphical user interfaces. Properties of objects that reveal how users may interact with them are called affordances, which are important to understand when designing easy-to-use, intuitive interfaces. Examples are images of folders to denote file directories and buttons with bevels to let users know they can click on them. But the overall aesthetic at the time was quite restrained due to the low resolution of the black and white displays, so designers couldn't deliver richer experiences. This changed in time. As technology evolved, around the turn of the century, both Microsoft and Apple introduced colorful, skeuomorphic user interfaces with plenty of highlights, shadows, and gradients. This trend of increasing graphical richness and sophistication was ongoing when the proliferation of the World Wide Web started occurring. Designers in the early years of the web were especially explorative on this front, using animation and sound together with images to produce excessively rich and often dazzling experiences. When Apple introduced its first mobile system, the interface still contained complicated textures and skeuomorphic cues. However, at some point during the last 10 years, designers realized that people can, in the meantime, operate digital interfaces without reference to real-world objects, and so skeuomorphism, with its difficult-to-design elements, started giving way to simpler constructs. This, at the same time, ushered in the era of return to basic design principles based on human psychology. The web naturally followed this trend. Early table-based and flash-based designs had given developers pixel-perfect control over their interfaces, and so designers had not hesitated to create visually rich containers for their content. But as we began to grasp the fluidity of the new medium and to disconnect presentation from content using style sheets, so-called CSS files, web design became more restrained. Highly decorated containers could not change their width and positions easily, so designers relied more and more on simpler CSS styling to make their layouts more adaptive and easier to maintain. Just as a refresher, designs that can adapt to different screen sizes of laptops, tablets, mobile phones, etc. are called responsive. A term that in everyday use encompasses its precursor, fluid design, where layouts are built using percentages for widths, and also its difficult-to-maintain alternative, adaptive design, where specific devices are targeted. But more about all this later. In any case, these changes led us towards a simpler, content-focused web aesthetic, one that derives its beauty from typography, spacing, and color rather than from a heavy use of textures and decorative images. Gone are raised buttons, images with shadows, and shiny glass textures, leaving us with a much simpler concept called flat design, representing a cleaner, more functional aesthetic, which is at the same time much easier for non-professional designers to handle. From a historical perspective, these developments brought us full circle back to when the industrialized societies in the West embraced simplicity, getting rid of the ornamentations and extravagances of earlier times. This was when the progressive radical movement known as the Swiss design style swept through Europe, exported to the rest of the world to become internationally acclaimed by the 1960s. Now, the reason I mention this is because I was educated some 30 plus years ago in Switzerland by the two masters of this école and have obviously carried this influence with me throughout the years, despite having learnt and used quite a large number of other design styles as well. Therefore, I think it would be fair to say a few words about the Swiss design style so you have a better understanding of my background. The Swiss design style can be defined as an authentic pursuit for simplicity and the idea that form must follow function. It is characterized by a keen attention to layout, color, and typography rather than textures and decorations. Antoine de Saint-Exupéry once said, "Perfection is achieved not when there is nothing left to add, but when there is nothing left to remove." In that sense, the Swiss style searches for the minimal design that will help the content make an impact. This is a great example of the less is more principle that many designers have embraced of late. However, care must be taken that what is necessary remains, something they often forget. But more about this later. The Swiss design style was born in an institutional context. The majority of pieces from this movement were in the form of posters, stamps, institutional typographical identity, street signs, etc., which sought to create the earliest known user-friendly interfaces. What mattered was that the content could convey its intended message in a clear, unobtrusive fashion. Important design principles were uniformity of geometry, white space to let the content breathe, using grid systems for achieving consistent organization of information, coherent page layout, semantic structuring of data, paying a lot of attention to unobtrusive typefaces to use their potential to replace other design elements. Where, for instance, Helvetica, famous for its pervasiveness and one of many typefaces developed in Switzerland, was used in corporate identity, street signs, magazines, and pretty much everywhere else. Continuing with the design style, using font size as a tool for readability, impact and rhythm, providing readers with a hint about the hierarchy of the presented data, leading their eyes through the page, thus working as an interface to the content, and the remarkable use of large size photography. Now, if all this sounds familiar, it is because there is a direct correspondence to what is fashionable in web design as of the recording of this lecture. Obviously, things never stay the same, and web designers, like their counterparts in fashion industry, love change. However, flat design, or the somewhat more elaborate material design of Google, offer great opportunities to designers to get a hold of what the interaction between content and design really means. Simplicity is not a temporary trend. It is the manifestation of a desire for greater authenticity in design, a desire to curb visual excess and eliminate the fake and the superfluous. And this is also where psychology-driven design is at home. People sometimes refer to some aspects of it as distinctive design, as it uses visual weights and content elements to show users quickly what to focus on and where to go next. It underlines the ideal that what we display should fit the ideas we wish to convey. Content and design are interrelated. Websites that are based on off-the-shelf themes by themselves cannot claim this relationship, as a theme is always built on dummy content. Only when you work with real content can you begin to truly transform function into form. And this means that with such tools, it is even more important to understand concepts that will be presented in this course so you can properly stylize your site after content has been added. Up next, we will take a first glimpse at how psychology-driven design can transform websites. See you there.